Welcome back to It's Ave. If you watched the last segment, you saw two of our most wonderful students, Emily and Paula, talking about what the arts have meant to them, what their Ave Maria University has meant to them. And you might have heard them during the interview talk about the famous Dr. C. And so now I'm very happy to welcome to It's Ave Dr. Travis Curtright, who's the chair of our Department of Humanities and who's also the founder and leader of Shakespeare and Performance at Ave Maria University. Travis, welcome to It's Ave.
Thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Boy, those students love you.
Well, I mean, love them too.
They get a twinkle in their eye when they talk about you and what their Shakespeare and Performance experience has been. And you can tell that when they think of their 4 years at Ave Maria, they think of, what, 8 million practices and music and do this over. And I mean, it must be very personal for you. Yeah. To be walking with these young women as they discover inside themselves that actress that was hidden.
Yeah, it's beautiful to see, especially to watch them improve and to grow in confidence. And I tell them that John Paul II talks about a sincere gift of self, but there's an artistic corollary to that, and that's the gift that they make to the role they play, to the troupe to which they belong, and to the production that we put on. And to watch them develop is amazing. It's great.
Yeah, they just seem to, their eyes shine with delight when they talk about this is what Shakespeare and Performance was like in 10 different performances. Yeah. I want to go back to the very beginning of when you personally felt that God was leading you. I mean, Shakespeare's now been gone 400 years, right? Isn't that, didn't we just have the anniversary of his death?
Yeah.
So you weren't a contemporary, but when did you first come to start to realize I'm interested in this master's work?
Well, when I was in graduate school, I wrote my dissertation on Shakespeare and his uses of classical rhetoric. And then when I started teaching at Ave Maria 12 years ago, I offered a course for the literature department on Shakespeare's plays. And I would begin the course with a seminar question on some particular play, anything. So did Othello ever really love Desdemona? And some students would say yes, others would say no, then they'd argue about that question, and then I just started staging scenes based upon how they interpreted the play and let them direct it, and then the students started to say, you know, you really need to direct us in a production. And that was the impetus and the genesis of it. I thought then I needed some further training, so I went and did some professional training in Shakespearean acting, and then came back, and we launched the troupe in 2012, and this was our fifth production this spring.
But you've got such, it must have been a difficult transition in some ways. I mean, you're an internationally known scholar on Thomas More. Yeah. You've written about him. Your books are widely read and cited. To go from being into so much into Thomas More's life and into literature and your professor life as a professor in literature, to transition to Shakespeare, was that a hard move? It seemed like you left one career for another.
Well, I thought it was a natural bridge. Thomas More was an actor himself, and Roper records an anecdote in which More would jump into a play already underway and make a part for himself, throwing the whole production into consternation and confusion. And that was sort of interesting to me. And as I started to look at it, both More and Erasmus were educators who sort of brought classical rhetoric to what became known as the English grammar school. And what I discovered is that those English grammar schools had a huge emphasis upon performance. So they'd have to give declamations or set speeches, and they would do it in the persona of a fictive character from literature. They would put on small plays, and it was intrinsic and pervasive to their educational program. And what they thought they got out of that was training in audacity, that they could make leaders who were daring and who could be eloquent and who could guide other people. And I thought, you know, I wonder if that's still not true. Uh-huh. And so the Shakespeare performance regimen actually was a natural outgrowth of my work on Moore. And I've witnessed the kids become leaders, become eloquent, become confident because of what they did on the stage.
Wow, well, I think it shows. And I think that just from this A Winter's Tale, which is not your typical production. I mean, often you've had different productions on the campus. This one had people crying instead of from laughter, but from the tragedy. How many years have you had the performances actually on the Ave campus?
5 years.
5 years of performances. Do you have a favorite?
I don't know. Each one is a new challenge, and I also pick plays that are fitted to troupe members and to where they're at and their skills and where they can be taken to. And so this year I had a group of seniors, an exceptionally large number of them, who had been with me for as long as 3 years. And so I wanted to pick a very challenging play. And The Winter's Tale was one of Shakespeare's last plays. It veers from comedy to tragedy and back and forth again. And so the sheer scope and range of it was a great challenge for the actors. But I thought this group could do it, and they did.
Yeah, I don't recall in The Winter's Tale that there was, in Shakespeare's version of it, there was tap dance.
Yeah, that's right.
But Paula was talking about that and how, you just saw her again as she was sharing that story. Of course, they attribute it to your genius, and I have to say, when I watched it, it worked.
Yeah.
It worked for a contemporary song, and so you have these troupes come in for musical interludes. What's the purpose?
Well, we do adaptations of Shakespeare's plays, and so I like to think of students as creative collaborators. And so when students come to Shakespeare in performance, it's not necessarily a professor-student relationship. It's work a community of artists who are contributing to this collaborative enterprise. And then, of course, the audience later becomes a collaborator as well. And so a lot of the individual talents that they have can help me tweak a production. Shakespeare himself used music, but they were, you know, period-specific, of course, to his own day. And what I do is take contemporary music that I think can comment upon the play's action or prognosticate about what may happen, or sometimes add atmospherics. And so that opening scene of Leontes is the scene in which he's saying goodbye to Polixenes, and I re-envisioned it as a going-away party for Polixenes. And then that's why I put that song in by Cups. And then we had some fantastic tap dancers. And Mary Catherine Beller is the one who choreographed it, and she was great. So a collaborative enterprise.
Well, it worked, I must say. And you like, of course, to keep it authentic, you like it to be in the round.
Yeah.
You like it with the lights on so that it is interactive. Why is that important?
Well, the big lesson for me is that Shakespeare writes for a particular kind of environment. So the fact that the lights are up and that they perform on a thrust stage with the audience on all sides means that the audience is intrinsic to the creation of meaning. Yeah, the sense of or the aesthetic of realism that we play with involves audience interaction. And that makes a big difference. So most people watch movies on their laptops, and you know, a movie may have millions of viewers, but whomever watches the movie, however many hits those videos have, those people who watch it are in isolation from one another. And I think theater should be about community, that the person who sits next to you is relevant to the production of the show. Our actors will speak to them, speak to you, and then we can sort of bring the room together. And that's one of the things that's really interesting to see. We do 10 shows in part because, first of all, the students improve as we go, but also because each audience brings something that's a little bit different, and each audience has their own comment, and each audience has their own dynamic of play with one another.
Right.
So it is beautiful to watch.
So we're all just actors in our chairs.
Well, yeah, all the world's a stage.
Well, sometimes I would think that kind of interactivity can lead to odd consequences and surprises, because you never know how all of a sudden someone's going to launch out with their own acting career. Has that ever happened in the productions?
Yeah, that's right. We've had some issues. So, you know, we try and sometimes give a prop to an audience member who then decides that he won't return the prop. sometimes I've had an audience member refrain from giving a kiss to an actor who ask for one, but it adds to the show, because
that wouldn't have been my wife.
It is you who have said so.
I do recall a freshman student going to kiss Mrs. Towey, and she kissed her hand and tapped him on the cheek.
That's right.
And I thought that was a suitable compromise.
I thought that was a great compromise. We had five sisters who viewed the show, and that particular actor is particularly daring, and he offered his cheek to each of them and was refused each time, but they loved the joke. They thought it was a riot, and I told him afterwards, James, there's nothing wrong with kissing a nun. Just don't make it a habit.
Well, I have to say, Travis, I mean, I've watched you and your family. This is a family affair, you and Mary.
Yeah.
You really take these students into your lives, into your home. It becomes a real relationship. How's this work without Mary Curtright in your life?
It doesn't work. She is fiercely loyal and in love with each of the students. They know it, and it provides a dynamic in which all of them feel comfortable. And that's a big part of getting on stage. You know, with the lights up and you can see people in the audience and then the kinds of things that we're asking them to do, we all sort of have to grab arms and jump together. And that not only is a big risk for them, but they have to know that they have a safe landing place, right? No matter where they jump, they're always going to land safely in our arms. And my wife's a huge part of that environment.
Yeah, and your faith radiates through your work. And I would think Ave Maria University's take on drama, on performance, is different from a secular university's take. How would you describe that?
Well, I borrowed a line from Mother Teresa who said, make your lives beautiful for our Lord. And my addition to that is, make your lives beautiful for our Lord by sharing Shakespeare's beauty with audiences.
And that seems to have gone very well for you.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts about next year, real quickly?
I'm looking at Love's Labor's Lost, which is a story about how a group of young men decide that they will forswear love in order to study philosophy. And then some young ladies arrive who cause them to reevaluate their promise.
Is this a comedy or tragedy?
It's a comedy. And the other play I'm looking at, Love's Labor's Lost is the top candidate right now.
Very good. Well, I know that whatever you put your hands to, whatever script that you have, you will deliver beauty to these audiences. Dr. Curtright, thank you for all you do at Ave Maria University and for sharing your gift with us. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment to close out this program. We'll be right back.